Look at this map. This is the map which shows the extent of Ashoka's empire. After his victory, that means Ashoka's victory at Kalinga, Ashoka's empire was extended from Hindu Kush. You could see that from Hindu Kush in the northwest, this is what? Hindu Kush in the northwest to the river Pennar in the south. River Pennar in the south. And it also included some parts of Nepal. You could see that the entire colored one. It also included some parts of Nepal in the north and Kabul, Herat, Kandahar. Now these are the provinces which are there in Afghanistan as well as in Pakistan. Provinces outside the present boundary of India. So that is why we say that the Mauryan Empire was pan-India character. Means here the empire spread, all India empire. It was all India empire. Then let us move to that Ashoka's religious policy. That means here Ashoka's Dhamma. So what is meant by the term Dhamma? Dhamma means here it is not related to, that means according to Ashoka's edicts, it is not a religion or a religious system, but it is a moral law, or you say a common code of conduct, or you say that an ethical order, which commonly we say that disciplines, or you say the principles which should be adopted in each and every individual, so which is common meeting ground of all the religion. That means you could see all these policies in all the religions, but he made it compulsory to follow by his people. So let us find out what are the main principles of Ashoka's Dhamma. So the first one is here, respect to elders and love to children. That means here how elders are expecting the respect from the youngsters, in the same way the youngsters are also should be given importance by the elders. Next is about ahimsa or non-violence. That means he followed the policy. In that you could see that one of the consequences, he left hunting, even eating meat and also the luxury life. So he was not only propagating these principles, but he was following himself. Then next, third one, good deeds are the good karma that would give happiness to man in the next birth. That means here, shows mercy, kindness, generosity to the others and giving alms, or do the charity work like that. He explained the details of doing the good work. Then next, respect to all the religions. This I already told. He followed the policy of secularism, what we see today. So he gave respect to all the religions. That means he adopted Buddhism, he made Buddhism popular, but at the same time he respected Jainism, Hinduism also. The next thing is here, he disapproved empty rituals. You know that the Vedic rites, yajnas, yagas, then all unwanted grandeur celebrations and all, he disapproved. He followed only the simple faith. Then let us find out what is the impact, that means the result of this Dhamma on Ashoka's imperial policy. He was a great emperor. How did it affect his emperorship? See here, the first thing is here, the religious unity. People belonging to different religions followed their emperor's policy of religious tolerance. That means it is the Ashoka is the best example to say that Yatha Raja Tatha Praja. Ashoka not only propagated, he followed, he made the people to follow that. Next, moral values. People under the influence of Dhamma started living a moral life. That means here, he propagated more of morals and the ethics in the life of people. Next, the end of crimes. The policy of ahimsa did have a great impact on people. Theft, crimes and other such activities almost came to an end. That means the criminal activities came to an end. People now started having that cooperation. Then the friendly, that means you can say that brotherhood, all these things were achieved. Next is about the public welfare. With the policy of conquest and wars have come to an end, Ashoka's Dhamma helped officials to undertake public welfare, public work. That means instead of spending about the war and the war, the practices related to the war, now they spared the time for public welfare and public welfare schemes. So this resulted in prosperity and helped the people to lead a peaceful life. That means you could say that Ashoka was the most successful ruler of this 4th century BC. What even today we could not achieve, it was achieved by Ashoka the Great. Children, now we are going to learn the Mauryan administration. Mauryan administration and other, first the Pan-Indian character. What is meant by Pan-Indian character? The Mauryan Empire, beginning with Chandragupta Maurya, was vast with an all-India character. You could see the map here. You could see that India's empire, that means the Mauryan Empire, was not only in India, even with this Afghanistan, up to Afghanistan also, you could see that they covered the vast area of India, almost all parts of India. Start from Himalayas to South Mysore, then Afghanistan to Myanmar, you could see that all the colored area here. So this is what they say, that Pan-India character. Let us find out the main advantages of this Pan-Indian character. So the chief advantages of the Pan-Indian character of Mauryan Empire are like this. You can see that it marked the end of small states. It helped in establishing the trade links with the foreign countries. It made India strong and helped the Mauryan kings face foreign aggression successfully. After Ashoka's victory over Kalinga, the era of conquest and wars were over. It helped the Mauryan kings to pay more attention to social and economic life of people. Hence, there was an all-round development, especially the economic prosperity in the empire. Now, let us go to the administration. In the administration, there were two main divisions that you could see here, civil administration and military administration. Under the civil administration, again the two divisions, central government and provincial government. First, the central government. King was the supreme authority and his throne was hereditary. He was also the supreme judge and the supreme commander of the armed forces. And you could see that the second point, the king was assisted by the council of ministers, that is Mantri Parishad, aided by the prime minister. Then each minister was responsible for his department, just like the present one. Each minister is responsible for their portfolios. Then the council of ministers included the chief pujari of the state, who is known as Purohit, Senapati, that means nothing but commander-in-chief, who advised the king on matters related to the war and peace. Then the head treasurer, it is related to the financial matter. He was called Sannidhata, and Samartha, he was in charge of taxation. Then next, Ashoka. During the time of Ashoka, he himself took periodical tours of the kingdom and brought about small changes in the administration system, and he appointed Mahamatras, that is governors, to look after the welfare of his subjects. Then we move to the provincial government. See, all these things even today we could see, but with the different name. Those days they did not know the concept of the nation or the country. So there the vast territory was known as the empire. Then for the purpose of administration, the empire was divided into the provinces. Now presently what we have, the union of states in that manner. Now during Chandragupta Maurya time, there were 4 provinces. Then after the addition of Kalinga in Ashoka's time, there were 5 provinces. This is shown here. You could see that Magadha, the main kingdom. Magadha, capital Pataliputra. Gandhara, the present Afghanistan. The capital Takshila. Then Avanti, the Maharashtra, that means the western India. Then the capital was Ujjain. Then the southern province, present Andhra, Karnataka. Then capital was Swarnagiri, then Kalinga, the coastal Odisha, capital was Toshali. Then Along with this, you could see that the head of the provinces were known as Kumara or you say Aryaputra. During Ashoka's time, what had happened? These Kumaras or you say Aryaputras were assisted by the governors. They were known as Mahamatras. Besides Mahamatras, the other officers also served the empire. Who are those? Your Pradeshika, one who collected the taxes. Rajuka performed the functions of modern day Tashildar or the revenue officer. And the Yukta was the treasurer. The district administration. The provinces were divided into districts called Janapadas. Their administration was looked after by Pradeshika, Rajuka and Yukta. Then the administration of cities. It is nothing but the local self-governments at present. The head of the city was called Nagaradhyaksha. How the mayor now, the present mayor, in the same way. According to Megasthenes, the administration of Pataliputra, that means the capital city of Mauryan Empire, was looked after by a committee of 30 members. That means a board, a corporation board is there. In the same way, the board was there and it consisted of 30 members to look after the capital city. Then we move to the revenue system. What was the main source of revenue, or you say the income of the Mauryan Empire? That was nothing but the land revenue. The land revenue was the chief source of income in the Mauryan Empire. And it was 1/6 and to 1/4 of the produce. And two kinds of taxes, namely Bali and Bhaga, as mentioned in the edicts of Ashoka. Bhaga was levied on agricultural produce and the cattle at the rate of 1/6. Then, according to Vincent Smith and Shama Sastri, Bali was a religious tribute. Along with this, toll tax was imposed on articles which were brought for sale. Taxes were also levied on liquor shops and gambling houses. Some taxes were collected from forest and mines. From the revenue collected, the state provided various facilities like roads, irrigation, hospitals and met other expenses of the state. Means here, the taxes were used for the welfare of the people. Next, the spy system. Chandragupta Maurya had a wide network of spies in his empire. There were spies against the spies, and an important matter, more than one agent was asked to collect information. They collect the information start from high officials to the lowest cadre, and they reported, that means the spies reported to the ruler the weakness of the government so that the emperor could rectify all the weak points and correct the errors. Next, we move to the military administration. Chandragupta Maurya maintained a huge army consisting of infantry, cavalry, elephants and chariots. According to Megasthenes, the Mauryan army consisted of 6 lakh infantry, 30,000 cavalry, 9,000 war elephants. And according to another source, the Mauryas maintained 8,000 chariots. And the chief weapons used were bows, arrows, shields, swords, etc. And then the king himself was the commander-in-chief of the armed forces. The whole army was under a military commission of 30 members. The Mauryas also had a well-laid recruitment policy. The soldiers were paid salary in cash. The Mauryan kings had built forts at strategic places for the safety and security of the empire. Means here, the Mauryan rulers were the most successful. That means in administration, all types of administration, then the social welfare schemes, then in the disarmament policy, everything you say that they are the all-round achievers of India, even today where we could not reach to that level. Okay, children, study well. Go through the points whatever I have shown here. Then I am going to give you a set of questions. So go through these questions, find the answers and sit and study properly, children. Okay. So here is your questions. Go through these questions, children.